Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 16 tonight. 1 Corinthians chapter 16. I'll do my best to open my Bible there as well. You find it? Don't look up, you'll lose your place. Let's go ahead and look at verse 35. And I'd just like to read verses 35 through 39 to establish our context this evening. And then we'll actually probably go through most of the final part of this chapter. Verse 35, scripture reads, "But some men will say, how are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come?" I'm sorry.
Not 16 then?
That's chapter 15. I'm sorry. I'm looking at 16 in my Bible, but the page before is 15. Thank you. Well, that was confusing, wasn't it? There aren't 35 verses in 16.
I thought my Bible was missing pages. Was missing words.
Yeah. That time you got mad and ripped it out.
Now
you're
ripping it out.
Yeah. All right. Let's try again. You ready? Verse 35 of chapter 15. All right, but some man will say, how are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? Thou fool, that which thou sowest is not quickened, except it die. And that which thou sowest not that body that shall be, but bare grain, it may chance of wheat or of some other grain. But God giveth it a body as it hath pleased him, and to every seed his own body. Let's read verse 39. All flesh is not the same flesh. But there is one kind of flesh of men, another flesh of beasts, another of fishes, and another of birds. Well, let's pray. Father, please help us to have understanding this evening. And God, we just thank you so much for this explanation that's in the scripture tonight that will help us to understand what kind of a body we'll have when we have our spiritual body and what it'll be like when we're in heaven. And so I pray that you would just help us as this evening we look at understanding the process of being resurrected. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, that really is what this is about. It's the process of the resurrection. Jesus Christ was resurrected, and the Bible says that we also will be resurrected and have a body like his glorious body. I don't know if it's happened to you yet, but I've come to realize that this body is cursed, and it's progressing in that direction. I years ago realized that all I have to do is make my body last until I die, and then I won't need it anymore. And so, you know, my wife told me when I was in my early 20s, she said, by the time you're 30, you're going to be in a wheelchair. And it really seemed like I was heading that direction. But baby, I'm 40, and I haven't been majorly injured in quite a while. And so, but it just seemed like for a couple of years, you know, you don't know your limits. And when you're young, I'm not sure you have limits, or if you break things, it just heals up. But there's something magical that happens about every 5 years after 20, where your body degenerates and the healing process slows down. And I'll tell you though, there are days when I just realize, man, when your body, when it doesn't function, it doesn't matter what you want to do. You're not doing anything that you can't physically do. That's just it. That's just the way it is. And, you know, those are good reminders for me that, first of all, life is temporary. Life is short on this earth. But eternal life is forever. And this body is temporal. It's temporary and it's cursed. And it helps me to long for a body which is not sin cursed. We'll actually look at, in the second letter to Corinthians, we're going to actually look at Paul's attitude on that. He really sheds light. It's almost like he follows up this letter with more information on the glorified body. But you know, a lot of believers, we have some strange notions about eternity and eternal life. And we use generic terms like heaven and hell, don't we? The reality is that the word heaven means heaven, that is, not earth, outside of the earth or the heavens. And where God is somewhere beyond the heavens. You know, so a lot of times we'll say God is in heaven. Well, actually, We don't know where God actually is, but He's in the heavens or beyond the heavens, and He transcends the heavens. And so we use a generic term where we talk about where God is. Jesus called it His Father's house. He said, in My Father's house are many mansions. We know in the Revelation we're going to see the New Jerusalem that comes down over the earth. And men are able to go from earth and just go right up into the presence of God. And so we know that there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. I don't know about you, but storybook notions and paintings make me desire heaven less than I do when I read the Scripture. How about you? You ever see a cherub? You know, a little dude that looks like a baby playing a harp? And that's like, that he's in heaven, you know, playing a harp. He's floating in a cloud, a little naked baby with a harp with little wings on. And I'm just thinking, that doesn't seem like a lot of fun to me. And, you know, heaven is less glorious in my mind than the pictures that are painted. I love it, the way Mark Twain described heaven in Huckleberry Finn. I'm not trying to promote the book or whatever this evening. I happen to get a kick out of Huckleberry Finn. And when Huck Finn is adopted by the widow and taken into her house, he describes the difference between the way that she talks about heaven and the way Miss Watson, who was her sister, described heaven. He basically said, when the widow Douglas would describe heaven, it would make your mouth water and you'd want to go there. But he said, when Miss Watson described heaven, he said, when she described heaven, he decided he'd rather go to the other place. And so the other thing that Huckleberry Finn said, he asked her if Tom Sawyer would be in heaven. She said, not by a long sight. And he guessed he didn't want to go there anyway. Well, there are a lot of notions like that that people share about heaven. For instance, some people talk about heaven and hell, like hell is a party place, or, you know, it's a place you're going to go and be with your friends. Well, the descriptions of hell in the Bible are that it's a place of torment. And that it's a place where there's weeping, wailing, and gnashing of teeth. It's a place of outer darkness. It's not a place where there's interaction with other individuals. It's not a place where you're going to go and party. You know, sometimes people present hell as it's sort of being like the devil's place. You know, it's kind of like the devil's den. And it's where he's the manager, he's got his pitchfork, and he's keeping the flames hot there. But he's in charge of hell. No, the hell is a place where the devil is sent for torment. Mm-hmm. And it was a place that was designed for the devil and his angels, and where God has no plan, no purpose for any person to go. God's plan for every individual is for us to be with Him and to be reconciled, redeemed to Himself. Heaven is in many ways indescribable. I think the best way to describe what heaven is and what the new earth are going to be like would be to go back to the Garden of Eden and look at the descriptions of what pre-sin cursed earth was before man sinned, before the earth became cursed. And I think that probably for us, that would be the best idea of what heaven and the new earth will be like someday. Now, having said that, we know that the Bible also says that eye hath not seen nor ear heard, neither hath entered into the heart of man. And so when it comes to heaven, the actual truth of the matter is that no one living has ever seen anything like it, no one's ever heard anything like it, and no one's ever imagined anything like it. You know the contemporary Christian song, I Can Only Imagine? Mm-hmm. You can't. That's what the Bible says about heaven. So you could just add, I can't even imagine. And that would be more accurate when you sing about heaven, because that's the reality of it. Now, the great thing about it is it's so glorious that it supersedes our imagination. Isn't that wonderful? I look forward to being in a place. You know, I like activity. The idea of not doing or making or building or learning anything, it just makes it seem like, you know, I remember as a kid having teachers tell me, we're just going to be in the presence of God, bowing and worshiping Him forever. That's all we're going to do in heaven. Well, that's not all we're going to do in heaven. We're going to rule and reign with Jesus Christ on earth, and it's going to be a real location. And the way that we live in the new heaven and the new earth is going to be dependent on how we live in this life, actually. And so how we live now impacts heaven, impacts eternity. And again, I'm using the term heaven generically, and understanding it's not, you know, a place that's That's the name of it, but it's a place in the heavens. But we're going to live on a new earth. And we're going to inhabit the new earth. And we're going to do what the first Adam didn't do on the new heaven and the new earth. Okay, so we've been talking last several weeks. We've been looking at the resurrection. There's been one of the errors, the doctrinal errors in the church at Corinth was that people didn't believe that there was a resurrection. In other words, they just believed, though Jesus Christ was risen, and though they believed that God was real and that salvation was real, they just believed that you die and you go into the ground and that's it. And so they said there was no resurrection of the dead. And Paul dealt with that very handily. And he proved the resurrection by proving that Jesus Christ is risen. We looked a couple weeks ago at the statement in the beginning of chapter 15 that if Christ is not risen, then our faith is in vain. And so, you know, some people have taken the first couple of verses in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and they've made it look as though, or they've interpreted it to say that, you know, you may have tried to believe in Jesus, but your faith may be in vain. That isn't the truth at all. Three verses in that passage explain what it means for your faith to be in vain. It simply means that if you believe in Jesus and Jesus Christ isn't risen, then your faith is vain. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept? So Jesus is risen, and therefore there is a resurrection. And so you'd have to go back and read the verses previous to our text this evening to come up to speed on that. But now tonight I want to look at the process of resurrection. This is cool, isn't it? We're not just told that there's a resurrection and just left to wonder about it. We're given details about how it works. And the illustration that we see tonight is like the illustration of a seed being planted. Seeds are amazing things, actually, aren't they? There are some seeds, and I haven't researched this, but I know that there are seeds that can literally be kept in a dry, cool place for years, years and years and years, and be planted, and something will grow from them. I mean, they can just last. And I don't know what the limit is. I'm sure that somebody that's interested in biology or something like that would know, would have an idea. But the fact of the matter is that a seed is dead for all practical purposes. No life in it until it's planted in the ground. Excuse me. It's buried, and then it is germinates, and it gives new life. And that's the illustration that Paul gives first. He uses some pretty strong language, actually, because of the foolish argument. Look at verse 35 again. But some man will say, so he's given the hypothetical. Somebody says, and he probably knows who it was that said that as well. Some man will say, how are the dead raised up? Okay, if the dead are raised up, how are they raised up? You ever dug up a grave? No. There's thank you. I'm glad you haven't. sometimes graves are exhumed, and guess what? There's bones. There's a body there. So if they're raised up, then why is the body still there? Well, that's a pretty good question, isn't it? It's actually a sound question. So the argument is, if the dead are raised up, it's talking about the physical aspect of the resurrection. And boy, by the way, I'm glad there's a physical aspect of the resurrection. 2 weeks ago, when we came to where we were at, one of the conclusions, or one of the things that we mentioned is that, you know, Christian burial is sort of important because of the testimony of the resurrection. In other words, I'm being planted here in hopes and anticipation of being resurrected. And just like in Matthew chapter 27, where when Jesus Christ said it is finished on the cross, the graves outside of the city of Jerusalem opened up and people came out of the graves and they walked into the city. And people that knew those people, that particularly we think the Sadducees would have been coming out, and during during that time the Sadducees, who did not believe in the resurrection, would have seen the saints, probably their relatives or people that were their acquaintances at the very least, walking into the city resurrected. And so this is something that I believe, because of the language in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that Paul is referencing or alluding to. He's saying, hey, you've seen the resurrection. Now, again, at the beginning of the chapter, he reminded the believers that more than 500 believers at once had seen the resurrected Jesus. The 12 apostles had seen Jesus. He himself had seen Jesus, and the Word of God testified of the resurrection. So the resurrection is real. So we're looking now at the process of it. Okay, so in verse 36, the answer is, okay, thou fool, that which thou sowest is not quickened. The word quickened is a good word for three words. that we could use, the three words we could use for that one word would be being made alive or being made to be alive. The word quickened is literally alived, if you will, but we don't use a word like that. So quickened is, though it's not as used as much in our vernacular, quickened literally means made alive, quickened. And so we would use it sometimes. We use quickened more often. We use the word quick in terms of speed. But the idea of speed for quickened really is the word lively. In other words, it's alive. You know, you ever see somebody, you wonder if they're alive or not at the rate that they get things done? It's like, come on, man. Let's move. Let's go. Quicken up. You know, get some life in it. You know, light a fire under it. And so the word quicken here, it's not the way we use quicken anymore, but it's the best word for it. And in verse 36, Paul said, "Thou fool, that which thou sowest is not quickened, except it die." You ever, I don't know if you ever harvested a kernel or of wheat or corn. You ever try to plant something green? You probably haven't, unless you did it when you were a kid or something like that. Fact of the matter is, until it's completely dried up and dead, a seed isn't good for anything. Until it's completely cured. And I mean, until it evidently has no life. It's hard and lifeless. Try to plant something green, it'll never grow. It'll just rot. Just rot away. But if it dies, it can be planted. And when it's planted, it germinates. And so he goes on to say in verse 37, "That which thou sowest not that body that shall be, but bare grain, it may chance of wheat or of some other grain." Now here's an interesting point. And I'm looking forward to the reality of this. When you plant a seed, do you get the same seed back? You get a different seed back, don't you? Now, I don't think the scripture here is indicating we get more than one seed, which would be kind of cool. I've always wanted to clone myself anyway. But you don't get more than one. You get one, right, of what is back. But you get a different one. And so Paul said, you're saying that, you know, why isn't that body raised up? Well, God raises up a new body. And it's going to be a glorious body. I don't understand the whole recognition thing in heaven, how we'll know each other and all those things. I suspect we'll look the same. But I hope some of you don't, really, truthfully. But I suspect we'll... That wasn't nice, was it? You're probably hoping I don't look the same when I'm in heaven. I don't really mean that. That just seemed like a funny thing to say. But the reality of it is that our soul is the person that we are. You ever just really realize that your body isn't you? And you can really get over yourself when you realize that. It's a good thing, actually. Some people are just so into looking or appearing to be a certain way. And they're more concerned about something that isn't actually who they are than they are about something which is actually who they are. And you're the person in you. You're not the person that you look at. I tell teenagers this all the time. You know, sometimes guys will meet a girl and they'll be like, "Oh, wow." You know, they think she's just beautiful. And I ask teenagers this, I say, "You ever met a girl and you just thought, wow, she is really pretty?" But then you get to know her and you realize she's not pretty at all, you know? And you ever met somebody, maybe you didn't even notice them at first, but then you realize, wow, they're beautiful. And what is it that makes a person really beautiful? What's the person they are? It's what's inside. It isn't what's outside. And man, I'll tell you something, you can make a mistake about that and you'll have problems. Major problems for a very, very permanent long time. And beauty is not something that's outward, it's inward. It's in the inward person of the heart. The scripture indicates that as well. And so the resurrection is not focused on, you know, being in these perfect, beautiful bodies so much as it is focused on having a body that's a spiritual body. Or did you hear that this evening? Notice the focus of the resurrection, the process of the resurrection, isn't so much about, you know, I'm going to have a perfect body someday. No, it's going to be about having a spiritual body someday. Now stop here just a minute and let's just think about this. Did anybody this morning really feel like getting out of bed?
Nope.
Why not?
I did.
Joel did. Okay. Yeah. You know, there are days, yeah, when, you know, Sundays are my day for getting up. I usually wake up and wait for my alarm so that, you know, I don't get up too early, because if I get up too early, by the time it's 10 or 11 o'clock Sunday night, it's just bad. But I wake up and usually wait for my alarm to go off because I want to get up. It's Sunday. It's my favorite day of the week. And that's just the way it is for me. I used to be when I'd go fishing. You know, fishing, you never go fishing really when you're serious about it unless you leave at 4 in the morning. It's like 4 a.m. is time to go fishing, right? And so every time I used to go fishing, used to be I'd wake up about 2:30 and just wait until it's 4 o'clock to go fishing. Now I better set my alarm because I won't wake up for that anymore. But I anticipate someone want to wake up. But you know, the limitation to staying up and getting up and feeling like doing something and not feeling like doing it, what is the limitation? Well, it's our flesh. It's our body. And this body, I mean, it just, man, I just have to work within its limitations. Spiritual body won't be like that. But more than that, can you imagine not having a desire to sin?
That'd be nice.
Could you imagine that?
Amen.
I mean, there's no struggle. There's no, well, should I not? You know, I know it, but man, there's just, can you imagine not having a sin? Where's your sin nature come from? Your flesh. So this body is sown, our corrupt is sown corruptible, but it's raised in incorruption. It's a spiritual body that's raised up. That is, it's a body that has no sin desire, no sin nature, no sin propensity. And that is a glorious concept. Matter of fact, I mean, some days I can't even relate to it. You know, our sin nature just makes us want to be sinners just a little bit. You know, like, well, you know, I don't know if I want to completely give up my sin nature. You know, we can't even relate to being in a sinless body because, man, our sinful flesh has just got such a hold. But I'm going to tell you something. The most wonderful thing that will ever happen is when our physical body, which is sown in corruption, is raised in incorruption. And it's not going to be about, wow, you know, so handsome, so perfect, so beautiful in that sense, because it'll be beautiful in a real sense, in a true sense. You know, that old beauty thing, man, I'll tell you what, it's debatable, isn't it? I won't go into that anymore because we've addressed it this evening. But it's not superficial, this body that we're going to have. It's not a superficial beauty, it's an actual spiritual body. Actually beautiful to match the person that you've been raised up to be. Okay, so the first aspect of the process is the dying and being planted. Let's just read down through verses 39. I want to read verse 38. The Bible says, "But God giveth it a body as it hath pleased him, and to every seed his own body." And that would be every individual seed, every person planted. And so it appears from verse 38 that you'll have the body God wants you to have. So, you all right? You just imagined the body God wants you to have, didn't you? Oh boy. All right, verse 39. We're going to see the comparison. All flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one kind of flesh of men, another flesh of beasts, another fishes, another birds. This is sort of a very, very basic illustration for someone who is asking a foolish question. How are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? Now, why is that a dumb question? I didn't actually answer the reason why that's a bad question or foolish question. We know why it's a foolish question is because we're talking about something supernatural. That is, we're speaking of something that God does. And we're asking a question as though man could understand something that God does that's miraculous. Does that make sense? Let me illustrate it for you another way. We're impressed, aren't we, by things that are impossible, by signs? You know, just like the Jews. Jews require a sign, but the Greeks seek after wisdom. We're impressed by things we see. In other words, when you talk about the miracles that Jesus did that prove that he was God, I'm impressed by every one of Jesus' miracles. I'm impressed probably the most by the raising of Lazarus. I'm impressed by turning water into wine. I'm impressed by walking on water. I'm impressed by rebuking the wind and the waves and there being an instant calm. I'm impressed by healing of the deaf and the lame and healing of the lepers. I'm impressed by all the miracles that Jesus did. But has it ever occurred to you that none of those things impresses God the least bit? Because when we talk about great things, some Christians, they want to, you know, have a miracle faith ministry and do miracles as though that would impress God somehow. God's not impressed by the supernatural. It's natural to Him. What's unnatural for us is natural to Him. So now, if an individual is going to say, well, how can God raise us up? And God will be like, well, you know, let me write a long letter. And I'll explain it to you. And then after that, if you have any questions, then I'll answer the questions and you'll understand. What do you think? No, you can't understand it. God does it. Listen, does our believing a truth precipitate upon our understanding? Does it? There's all kinds of things that we did tonight that have nothing to do with our understanding. Some of you may have noticed it's warm in here right now because I don't think we turned on the AC. Some of you know how an AC system works. And other people know how to turn one on and how to call an AC technician. Right? You know, we're not all the same as far as that goes, but you believe in air conditioning? Some of you, you're gearheads and you're into vehicles and you like to work on cars. And you can take one apart and put it back together or take it apart and put it together. It'll be better than it was when you took apart. And some of you know how to drive. A little bit, at least legally, sometimes. But the reality of it is that, you know, a lot of people drive vehicles, they don't know how they work. In other words, they know how to operate it, but they don't know how it works. If your believing something is precipitated upon your understanding it, you'd be pretty limited. If you could never do anything or never believe anything unless you understood it, you'd be limited. How many of y'all could fly? Fly an airplane. Yeah, Brother John could, he understands it. Yeah, there may be things that you understand you don't understand, but the reality of it is that our understanding doesn't make it true, and there are certain things that only God knows, but we know God. And so we know that God knows it. In other words, God has done enough things in my life that when I'm told that God can do something, my response is great. I'm glad to know that. Or when I'm promised God does something, my response is fantastic. I'm glad to know that about God. It isn't, oh, could God really resurrect a body? Listen, if God can raise Lazarus, God can raise me. And people saw it. If God can raise His Son from the dead, He could raise me, right? And so that's why that's a stupid question. And I didn't make that up. Paul called the hypothetical person that asked the question, who he probably knew their name, he called him a fool for asking the question. But he answered it because, you know, sometimes foolish questions, they get attention and people start to, you know, repeat. You ever hear somebody start off with a theory or something and it sounds like really smart or wise until somebody comes with a good answer? It's like, wow, that was a dumb question. Well, that happens. You know, just like Proverbs says, answer not a fool according to his folly, lest thou be like unto him. Then it says, answer a fool according to his folly, lest he be wise in his own conceit. This would be that second category. Better answer him or he's going to think he's smart. And when he's actually being a fool. And so that's what the scripture here says. Now, verse 40. There are also celestial bodies and bodies terrestrial, and the glory of the celestial is one. And the glory of the terrestrial is another. So celestial, heavenly, terrestrial, earthly. Verse 41, there's one glory of the sun, another glory of the moon, another glory of the stars. For one star differeth from another star in glory. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption. It is raised in incorruption. And that is the first answer. Okay, so the process of being resurrected is that we're planted or we're sown corrupt, and we're raised incorrupt. So that's the first truth. Okay, you're planted corrupt. You're raised incorrupt. Okay, now, there's some more description for it. Verse 43. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. I don't want to be too sarcastic here because this is could perhaps touch home. I'm not being sarcastic about this evening. But have you ever noticed that sometimes at funerals, people are remembered in their best, or remembered at their best. Whereas, let me try to tell you quickly. One of my favorite funerals I ever preached was for a man that was just as wicked as he could be. And I didn't know him, but I knew somebody that was used to be related to his family, and I was asked to do his funeral. And I went to their home, and I asked if he had a Bible. I got a Bible and I opened it up at John 3:16. He'd signed his name. At 1 John chapter 5, he'd written his name in. These things have I written unto you that believe. He'd written his name in. And he was just a rascal. I mean, he was a bad guy. His family was wicked. He was wicked. And he just had, you know, everybody thought it was fun. He went to the funeral. And the family had me run the whole funeral. They'd never done a funeral before, never been to one. And there were a lot of people there. He was a popular guy. There were probably 400 people at the funeral, hundreds of people there. There was a room with about 200 seats in it. And then outside of the room, all the doors were open, and there were people standing down the hallways in the back, and they were even standing in the inside of the room. It was just packed in a funeral home. And I opened up for people to share memories about this man, and it could not have gone more in a more conducive way to preach the gospel than the memories they shared. The first person to get up was his brother, and he said the first time and the second time I ever rode in a stolen car was with this guy. Another girl got up. She said, you know, when I was 16, he bought me and all my friends beer. And it just went on and on and on. Everybody's laughing and hee-hawing about just wickedness. And I just thought, man, they don't have anything righteous to say about this guy. After everyone was done sharing, I asked the question. I got ready to give a message. I asked, how many of y'all think, they called him Pop-Pop, was his nickname. How many of y'all think Pop-Pop's in heaven? After they just shared everything about his life. I mean, just wicked. And you could just see people just horrified. Scowls on their faces like, you could have gone all day and not asked that question. We know he's in hell. And that's what they thought. And I said, how many of y'all think he's in heaven? Not a single person raised their hand. And I said, well, I do. And I want to show you why. And I just showed him the process of salvation and that I believe that he trusted Jesus as his Savior in spite of what his life was. Man, he was redeemed by the grace of God. And, man, I'll tell you, you know, I gave an invitation. I've never seen so many people raise their hand that they prayed to be saved. He was completely out. There's no way in the world I could have dealt with anybody. And I just had everybody pray in a group and raise their hand. And I'll tell you what, it was quite so. You were at that funeral, weren't you? You were at the funeral. You didn't go. Danny was there, wasn't he? Anyways, it was just incredible. It's an amazing thing. Most of the time we don't go to people's funerals and talk about the wickedness that they've committed, do we? Mm-hmm. We have a saying in our family, we tease my mom, that as soon as you die, you become a saint. Like, you know, as soon as you're dead, you are just the greatest person. Tell your dad you're not a saint, but when you're dead, you know, my dad says, boy, I'm going to be great when I die. I'm going to be fantastic. And so we do, don't we, try to focus on, you know, the better things about people. Well, you know, that kind of, actually, that mindset kind of aligns itself with our text here this evening. Because the Bible actually says in verse 43, it's sown in dishonor, it's raised in glory, it's sown in weakness, it is raised in power. Man, if you've toiled alongside the bed of a person whose body is failing and you've watched them as they decline and they go into eternity, one of the most peaceful things in the world is when you realize, man, they've got a new body. They're sown in, they have a spiritual body. It's one of the most comforting things in the world. You never want someone that you love. You never want to be separated from them by physical death. But when it happens, there's a real comfort in knowing that it's raised in incorruption. It's just one of the most comforting truths. Now, believer, you say, Pastor, I don't know if I like talking about things like this. My friend, this is life. See, we live in mortal bodies, and this is something that we deal with and are dealing with. And it's comforting to know that there's a natural body in verse 44, and there's a spiritual body. So what we see is the natural body, but what God raises up is a spiritual body. And there's an order of the process. So in verse 45, we see the order, and so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last man, Adam, was made a quickening spirit. Isn't that beautiful? In other words, the first Adam we know is the Adam that sinned. He was a living soul, and then because of him, death passed on all men. The second Adam was Jesus, and he became a quickening spirit. That is, he is the one who is the life giver. And so the difference between the two, it could not be more stark, more contrasted. In verse 46, howbeit that was not first which is spiritual, but that which is natural, and afterward that which is spiritual. Okay, so there's an order. You see the order here? The order is first, natural, second, spiritual. If spiritual were first, there would not need to be a natural. There wouldn't be a need for it. In verse 47, the first man is is of the earth earthy, the second man is the Lord from heaven. As is the earth earthy, such are they also that are earthy, and as is the heavenly, such are they also that are heavenly. Then we see the result. Verse 49, and as we have borne the image of the earthy, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. Now, you say, Pastor, what does that mean, to bear the image of the heavenly? Well, all of us bear the image of the earthy, don't we? In other words, we all look human. We're only human, is what we'd say. And we're relatable in that sense. You know, just like we see, there's different kind of flesh. There are fish and there are creatures and there are flesh of man. There are different kinds of bodies. There are celestial bodies. There are terrestrial bodies. And even in the celestial bodies, there is the sun and the moon and the stars. And even the stars are distinct from one another. Well, there's a variety in us. But when the Bible talks about in the contrast between earthy but bearing the image of the heavenly, all I can think of are descriptions of heavenly beings. There's the only thing I know is what's described as heavenly beings. Remember the shepherds? Heavenly beings appeared to them, didn't they? And what happened? Well, as far as we know, it's quite a contrast. I remember the angel appeared to Mary. What do the angels always say? What are the two words an angel usually says first?
Fear not.
Fear not. Fear not. Don't be afraid. Sometimes they say, don't worship me, because they are obviously heavenly. Okay, so as far as I can understand the text this evening, I think that there would certainly be things here, again, that would be in the description of the heavenly, that is, cannot be described because I cannot relate to it. Eyes never seen it, ears never heard it, but we're going to be spiritually, in other words, what we're going to be resurrected as, the spiritual body, is going to be heavenly, and it's going to be absolutely amazing. It's going to be incredible. I don't have words. I don't have words to describe it, but it does create in me a longing, a desire for that day to come. I don't have a death wish, but I do sometimes feel like Paul, when he talks about in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, whether present or absent, you know, wherefore we labor, that we may be accepted of him. He says sometimes, you know, whether to be present in the body, absent from the body, is to be present with the Lord. And he says, you know, sometimes I want to be absent from the body so I can be with the Lord. And now Paul had that experience where he'd been caught up into the third heaven. He'd seen things that we haven't seen, things that he really couldn't even describe in the Scripture. And so you could certainly understand why he would more than others would have that longing, can't you? To go back to that place. Remember on the Mount of Transfiguration when Peter, James, and John were on the Holy Mount? What was their response? What did they say? They said, it's good for us to be here. Let's build tabernacles and remain. It's like, let's check out. Let's just go ahead and stay. You know, Jesus is in his glorified body and Moses and Elijah are there. This is great. And so that's the idea. Let me share something else. I've mentioned this many times, but I want to mention it because we need this for comfort sometimes. Oftentimes, when I remember a dear one that I'm separated from by physical death, but not separated from because they're eternal, they have eternal life. Oftentimes, as I fondly remember them and I miss them, I think I wish they could be here. I wish they could experience what we're doing. Maybe it's a family get together or whatever. And I wish that they, I wish they were here. And then I think, yeah, I wish they were here, but they don't. And that's comforting to me. I remember a guy just sharing with me something, and he is just using, you know, the fact that the Scripture says, as far as God is concerned, a day is as 1,000 years. God's very, you know, time is nothing to God. And when we are in our eternal bodies, we're going to be like God in that sense. And I remember just having described to me how much, based on, if you just do math and you calculate, how many minutes 1,000 year would calculate to, or how many days 1,000 years would calculate to in minutes. And you realize that, like, if you live 40 years beyond, say, a spouse that's lost or someone like that, it's about like 15 minutes in their mind. In other words, you know, when I leave, I miss my wife when I'm gone, but I can go somewhere 15 minutes. I don't take this the wrong way, but I can go somewhere 15 minutes and not miss her. I don't mean that in the wrong way at all, but you understand what I'm saying, don't you? And she's like, honey, how could you do that? But she, do you miss me? No, she's like, I need at least 15 minutes before I'm even ready to think about missing you. But the reality of it is, if you think about it in that perspective, there's nobody up in heaven going, man, I hope they get here soon. They're still just getting acclimated. They're still just starting to enjoy the presence of God. And I think that's comforting. I find it very comforting to know that, you know, sometimes you feel sad for somebody as though they're missing something or they're longing for something they cannot have. And the truth is that is the absolute opposite for it. And what that creates in me is a longing to have what they have and to be with them rather than them with me. And I think that that's a help from our text again this evening. A couple more things. The result. In verse 49, as we have borne the image of the earthly, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. And then, boy, we're just pretty much out of time. I wanted to get further this evening. Verse 50, now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. And so we see this statement in verse 50, that in order for us to be raised up spiritually, our body must die. In our flesh and blood, which is corrupt, it has to be buried. Now, what's God going to do with it? Well, He's going to raise it up. He's going to raise it up, and that's what we see in the last part. I've got to read through it, and I just won't be able to comment as much as I wished I could this evening. Verse 51, Paul said, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep. The word sleep here is used the same way as it is in chapter 11. It's talking about dying. It's talking about your body being dead, but not dead in the sense that it's finally dead because it's going to be resurrected. So it says, we shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. When your body dies, death has no more dominion over you. There's no sting to it. There's nothing it can do to you. In verse 57, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, forasmuch as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Now stop with me just for a minute and come back for just a second. And let's just conclude with verse 58, because this is absolutely incredible what the natural conclusion here is. You would think that the conclusion here would be, okay, so stop worrying about dying, or stop wondering about whether there's a resurrection. Therefore, my beloved brethren, stop worrying about dying, or stop wondering about the resurrection. But no, it doesn't. It says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable. And then it says, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. In other words, the inference from the text is that what you do affects what you'll be. The Bible, in 1 Corinthians, again, we saw what the rewards are for the things that are done in our body. In other words, Paul is taking us back to, it matters how you live. It matters how you live. And I'm glad for that conclusion, because the fact of the matter is that feeling good is nothing more than motivational speaking. In other words, I don't want to just preach a feel-good sermon to you here this evening. What I want to tell you is, based on what we've seen in the text tonight, go out and live for Jesus. Preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Live a sanctified life. Grow. Experience victory in areas that you have not before. Grow in the Word. Grow up in the faith. Add to your faith the things that make so that you're neither unfruitful nor barren. And stick by the stuff. Don't waver. You know, if you wonder whether or not there really is a resurrection, But just like Paul said, if in this life only we have hope in Christ Jesus, we're of all men most miserable. You know, what if there's no resurrection, there's nothing but religion. You know how many religions? I don't even know how many religions there are. Nobody does. Do you know how many religions just believe that you go into the ground when you die? Most sects of Judaism believe that today. Many Jehovah's Witnesses basically believe that today. And my thought on it is, why bother? I mean, if the consequence is you go in the ground, you rot, and you cease to exist anymore, you're just religious for a reason which I cannot fathom. I can't understand religion for the sake of religion. I don't understand it. I tell people all the time, I'd be the last person in the world to darken the doors of a church house if I hadn't been born again. It's not my cup of tea, folks. You know, if it doesn't mean, if all religions are valid and if everything everyone believes is all the same, we just go into the ground anyway, quit playing the silly religious game. It's nonsense. But no, it isn't. That isn't the case at all. Jesus Christ is risen. He's become the first fruits of them that slept. And we shall all be risen with Him. So be steadfast and unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Father, thank you for this long sermon we've had this evening. And I ask that, practically speaking, it would provide not only comfort, but motivation for us to abound in the work of the Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's take a few minutes and take some prayer requests, if you don't mind. Ms. Stallings, you have an update?